What is your view on the organizational structures that support scientific research? Often in some countries we have one ministry responsible for research. Coordination is desired, but is not always achieved. So governments try to put structures in place so this coordination can sort of be streamlined, and you know, a policy statement can then be translated into its desired impact.
In Ethiopia, we have a national science, technology, and innovation policy, which was enacted in 2012. Among the policy issues identified is research. We have 11 critically important policy issues in the policy, and research is one of the 11 policy issues. And to implement that, the government has also developed a strategy, the National Science Technology Innovation Policy Implementation Strategy. And in that strategy, there we have many key procedures to be followed for the policy issues to be implemented. As a country, the government has started to expand its higher education platform. When I was a college student, we had only two universities in this country of 100 million. But right now, we have 44 public universities. Our universities are, thank you. Our universities are the primary centers where we conduct research of any sector, because our universities are general universities from social sciences, natural sciences, and other disciplines. In addition, we have an organizations handling research in different ministries. For example, we have the Ethiopian Agricultural Research Institute, which was established 51 years ago. But that Agricultural Research Institute has research centers in different parts of the world to look into issues in the agriculture sector which can be solved by research. If you want to bring a technology to address some agricultural issue, it is through this research platform in the ministry that things go down to the grassroots level. We also have research institutes under other ministries. Under the Ministry of Industry, we have industry research development and institutions for the textile, for the laser, and other development issues. Within those development institutes, we have research wings. So those research wings take care of research issues of relevance to that sector. In the health also, the Honorable Minister will handle those issues, but we also have Ethiopian Public Health Institute established long ago taking care of health research issues. So this is the general organizational structure. But under the National Science Technology Innovation Council, which is chaired by the Prime Minister of the country, we have all cabinet ministers as members. That means whenever research is discussed as an issue, all the cabinet ministers take that assignment and put in their annual sectoral plans and follow issues down. To organize that, to coordinate that at national level, the Ministry of Science and Technology has been given the mandate of coordination and promotion of research in Ethiopia. And the ministry also serves as a secretariat for National Research Council. The National Research Council prioritizes research agendas, research issues, and follows other activities through the secretariat, which is the Ministry of Science and Technology. But one of the challenges we face as a country is, probably which is the case in many other African countries, is funding first, and the skilled and trained human resource second, and infrastructure third, and fourth is the research culture. If we address the four things we have, I've already mentioned, we can put things forward in promoting research in Africa and other parts of the world. Thank you.
From Sierra Leone, everybody knows what happened during the EVD crisis. You had all Tom, Dick, and Harry coming in, collecting data, collecting samples, collecting whatever it is they wanted. And that really showed us how weak the ethics committee, which we have for research. I am surprised I didn't see anybody here from the Ministry of Education, Science and Technology. Like I said previously, the recent Ebola outbreak actually has renewed a lot of interest in the research department, which was non-existent in Sierra Leone. We have three labs as we speak. One in Kenema District for Lassa fever, one in Laka for any other outbreak, including Zika, and one in Jala, which is purely for zoonotic research that we have been able to achieve as a country. Of course, we're talking about funding again. And what we, from the Ministry of Health and Sanitation, is trying to move away from is the loans. The loans, we don't want no more loans. We keep on asking for grants, they offer us loans that our children has to pay. If there are grants available, we can accept that. And again, I don't know how many women got invited out of the 100 that were chosen.
60%.
50%.
60%.
Thank you very much. Because in Sierra Leone, it's more empowerment to women, because the new ethics committee we have is actually headed by a Dr. Aisha Ibrahim Fofana. So women are not sitting down anymore. We are moving forward because we need to change things that is happening in Africa. Sierra Leone, actually, for a research to be effective, you have to take into consideration that the level of illiteracy is high. But one thing that we got to understand is that when you reach out to the women and you talk to them in the local dialect, you talk to them in a language that they understand, they are able to convince their husbands, they are able to convince their children. So we put everything in place for researches to be done. We have to reach the common people. We have to reach the communities. Taking into cognizance that there was a distrust about how Ebola came to the sub-region, what happened. The messaging at the beginning was wrong. It took us a while to convince them before they could start going to the hospital. So for us to have any effective research, set up in Sierra Leone, we can have as many labs as we can. We can have as many experts as we can. We can train as many women, men as we can. But if we don't communicate properly with the communities, we can test the animals, zoonotic, yes, but when it comes to human research on human beings, we have to really, really take that as the first step.
That's great. I really believe that communication is very important in research, communication of research results to the normal community members, to media, to everyone who is not research expert, because sometimes the language and the research terms are very difficult for someone who is not a scientific background to understand. And then we miss a lot or a big opportunity of benefiting and having health solution of this great research we invested our human resources and our financial resources on. So this is really great. I thank you very much, Mrs. Cooper, for this. I would like to ask Minister of Health of Ethiopia the next question. Research in cancer. I understand very well that in Ethiopia there is a big challenge of cancer care. Knowing that it's 100 million population and we maybe have one institution and three or four oncologists. So I know that the Ministry of Health has funded a big hospital four stories for chemotherapy, but the problem is how can you find the skills and the professional professional oncologists and human resources to run these facilities. In Merck, we have done a very good program called Merck Access, Cancer Access Program, where we're providing oncology fellowship, 2 years oncology fellowship for sub-Saharan African doctors. So they can train in two places. One, it will be in University of Nairobi, 2 years, and the other one in India, in Tata Memorial Center, which is a very famous place to cancer treatment. But how can Ministry of Health, with your leadership, new leadership, support this? How can we find out or select the candidates who can go through this fellowship program? And of course, this will also improve the research in cancer and cancer prevention and women cancer and all the other topics. But we need at least two oncologists to start research, yeah?
Before coming to the question, I would like to give you some highlight regarding the cancer and other non-communicable diseases. In general, as you well know, in several developing countries, non-communicable diseases were not getting much attention, and even in our ministry, there has been it was not a priority, and very recently, the ministry recognized it as an important health problem, and that's why we used to have only one cancer center in Addis Ababa. But recently, we developed a strategy, and we are establishing chemotherapy and radiotherapy centers in 4 regional states. This is a big progress. And we also open a postgraduate program on oncology. And now I think the first batch already graduated, and we are going to recruit more. So it's getting much attention. Malignancy in general is getting much attention because of the increasing problem. And it's not only by opening chemotherapy centers and radiotherapy centers. There is also a program of screening the commonest malignancy, which is the cervical cancer. And the government is committed also to provide vaccination for human papilloma virus for children 9 to 13 years. So these are already in the program. I think we'll be providing a better service for patients with malignancy, and I think we'll be in a better position to prevent the prevalence and incidence of the common malignancies, which are breast CA and cervical CA. Did I get your question? Yes. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. And maybe I will be in communication with your ministry to identify the candidates for the fellowship.
Generally, it's not only the media, our government. Professor Afork and I were in the university complaining on our government regarding research budget and the like. Now we are part of the government. There is no more to complain on our government. So I think we are in a better position again to work on research budget and research undertaking and like. So already there is a seeding, okay? Under the Ministry of Health, there are 2 agencies. One is dealing with biomedical research, and another one commonly on national surveys. This is, I think, good ground for us to scale up. Beyond communication, what I'm interested in is, let's recognize the importance of research for our development endeavors. This is first thing that we have to take very seriously as a government. Research is a vehicle for our development, and it's also an evidence for our day-to-day practice. And this is how the world changed. And we Africans also give emphasis to research, and the media should talk about not only European research findings, but also African research findings. If you watch our television programs, okay, daily they can talk about research reported from from European countries. But as they don't even the small, not as big as and high caliber like the developed world, but we need to know the evidences that we have for our policy and strategy. This is, I think, creating public awareness and also creating the creating the input and importance of research to our not only our predecessors, but also for our successors. People should know the importance of research for our program, for our, I think, academia as well.
Ministries actually fight for the budget, to take, you know, whoever can get more budget for their ministries. You know, in science particularly, the proof of the pudding, as they say, is by the publications that you produce, is by the scientific excellence that is produced. So I wanted to really get some feedback from both the panelists here from Angola and Kenya to perhaps to shed some light about how your countries are fighting for money for science, and what are you providing in terms of evidence to show that, you know, we deserve this funding.
Les organisateurs de ce sommet pour nous avoir invités, Excellences, Monsieur le Ministre, Excellences, représentants du gouvernement, et Excellences, le Ministre de la Science et le Ministre de la Santé de l'Éthiopie, merci pour votre hospitalité. Et on va présenter d'une façon résumée la politique des sciences et technologies de la République de l'Angola. Parce qu'on parle, on a des besoins, on veut que les femmes puissent faire des recherches, mais nous, on a appris qu'au lieu d'attaquer les effets, il vaut mieux voir d'abord les causes. Donc, c'est sur ça qu'on va parler. Nous aussi, on a, donc je vais demander qu'on passe, on a une politique de sciences, technologies et innovation. On a une stratégie et un mécanisme de coordination. Donc, on va vous parler des documents recteurs de la science, technologie et innovation en Angola. Vous pouvez passer. Tout d'abord, on va parler de... Next, please. On va parler de diagnostic, on va parler des documents principaux et on va parler des défis et finalement quelques conclusions. Si le diagnostic, le gouvernement de l'Angola avait demandé à UNCTAD, la conférence pour le développement et le commerce, de faire un diagnostic sur la situation de la science et technologie en Angola. UNCTAD l'a fait en 2005, en fait, a commencé de faire, oh là, avant. C'est pour ça que j'aimerais avoir l'UNCTAD a fait les diagnostics pendant 3 ans, donc la science prend du temps, il faut avoir du temps pour faire la science, 3 ans pour faire les diagnostics. Jusqu'en 2008. En 2008, on a eu les résultats du diagnostic. Next, please. La première chose qu'on a observée, qu'il y a eu une absence d'articulation entre différents acteurs de recherche et développement. Dispersion des moyens, des ressources humaines et des ressources matérielles. Next, please. Absence de mécanismes clairs de coordination des activités. Next, please. Et il n'y avait pas de règles. Tout le monde faisait la science, mais il n'y avait pas de règles. Next, please. Et il n'y avait pas un système. Au fait, il n'y avait pas la collaboration. Il y a des fois qu'on coopérait avec l'extérieur, mais les scientifiques du même pays de l'Angola ne coopère pas entre eux. Donc c'est pour ça qu'on a pris comme base la législation qui existait déjà, hein, entre lesquelles notre constitution de 5 février 2010, et sur la base d'un plan national pour jusqu'à 2025, on a fait alors la politique nationale des sciences, technologies et innovations. on a défini qu'est-ce que c'est la politique des sciences et technologies. En bref, la politique, c'est un ensemble des objectifs et des mécanismes pour faire la politique du gouvernement. Next, please. Quelle est notre vision comme gouvernement? Il faut avoir une vision. Quelle est la vision du gouvernement? C'est de faire que la science et la technologie soient un instrument capital pour le développement économique et social. C'est ça la clé. Next, please. Après la vision, il fallait voir quelle sera notre mission. Qu'est-ce qu'on doit faire? On doit faire que l'Angola soit un pays, au fait, qui doit être développé. Et que les jeunes gens, comme on a parlé des femmes et ainsi de suite, doivent être engagés dans le développement du pays à travers la science, technologie et innovation. Next, please. On a trois piliers fondamentaux de la science, technologie et innovation. Le premier pilier, c'est le développement du système national des sciences, technologies et innovation. Deuxième pilier, la contribution de la science pour le développement soutenable. Et le troisième, c'est le financement. Parce qu'on a posé la question du financement. Next, please. Mais ces piliers doivent être liés. Donc, c'est un système. Ce n'est pas seulement un pilier, mais ce sont aussi des vecteurs. Next, please. Voilà les objectifs du premier pilier. La capacity building, la formation des cadres. Donc, c'est le premier objectif. Deuxième, c'est la création d'une base matérielle. Après, et la coopération scientifique et avoir un cadre légal. Next, please. Le deuxième pilier, il y a quatre objectifs. La promotion scientifique, la culture scientifique, parce qu'il faut une culture scientifique tout d'abord. Et la réponse aux problèmes de la défense, sécurité, les problèmes sociaux, culturels et environnementaux. Les problèmes de l'économie et l'entrepreneuriat. Et l'action de la science pour la gouvernance. Donc la science aussi doit gouverner. On doit gouverner le pays scientifiquement. Next, please. Et le troisième pilier, bien sûr, c'est le financement. Pour financer les ressources humaines, la recherche, ainsi de suite. On peut voir qu'aussi, il y a plus de chercheurs, de professeurs à l'université que de chercheurs dans l'institution de recherche. On peut continuer. Bon, le slide là est très important. Regardez, entre 45 et 54 ans, il y a plus d'hommes que de femmes. Il y a plus d'hommes que de femmes. Mais si on regarde, à partir de 25 ans jusqu'à 34 ans, il y a plus de chercheurs femmes que hommes. Ça veut dire que les femmes maintenant sont plus de jeunes femmes dans la recherche scientifique en Angola. Et c'est normal. Auparavant, il y avait plus d'hommes et maintenant les femmes, elles commencent à prendre la place des hommes. On peut continuer. Et on peut voir le nombre de docteurs qu'on a. Et dans le domaine de la santé, c'est notre thème, il y a moins de chercheurs que dans le domaine des sciences humaines. OK? Dans le domaine de l'agriculture, il y avait encore moins. Or, que l'agriculture et la santé, c'est ça la base du développement. C'est pour ça qu'on a fait ce qu'on appelait le plan national de formation des cadres pour faire conforme plus d'ingénieurs, plus de médecins et pour avoir cet équilibre. Merci. Et le dernier. Voilà, il y a des conclusions et des remarques que je ne vais pas lire à cause du temps. Merci beaucoup.
So, before we go to Kenya, I want to show you what we have done in Kenya to improve research in cancer. Merck has launched, in partnership with University of Nairobi, I don't know if Professor Abinia is here, in partnership with University of Nairobi, yes, he's there? Yes. And he is the lead of this fellowship program for all sub-Saharan African countries, not only for Kenyan, to have 2 years oncology fellowship program. This will improve, of course, the limited number of oncologists in the continent and also improve cancer research in Africa. So just quickly, I will want to show the video to people just to break a little bit to see. The candidates here is not for University of Nairobi because we have another one for South-South collaboration with India. And these two candidates from Tanzania and from Ghana. But the similar program we developed especially for the first time in sub-Saharan African country in University of Nairobi.
A number of questions have been asked here, including infrastructure. We have seen discussion on cancer. And maybe I will start with what we do in Kenya, what's our infrastructure in Kenya. Our infrastructure almost parallels what the Minister for Ethiopia Science and Technology mentioned, and that's not a surprise because many of these policy structures are developed at a higher level of the AU. So we had a National Science and Technology Act that established several research institutions in various sectors, in the medical sector, in the agricultural sector, in the industrial sector, and as well as in the water sector. But a few years back, we looked back at the structure and whether it was serving the nation well. And in 2015, a new law was enacted in the parliament, the National Council for Science and Science Technology and Innovation. This act actually changed a lot of things because it created new structures in the manner in which science and technology would be conducted in the country. It created three different institutions. It created the National Council for Science, Technology and Innovation as a freestanding institution. It created a national research fund, and it created a national innovation center. And the reason why these institutions were created was because the country has been pushing and has been very keen on implementing some of the declarations that have been made in the past regarding funding support for research, or basically in science and technology. And this act, actually entrenched in the act, is the commitment that the government of Kenya will be providing 2% of GDP. We had 1% here. The government went beyond that to 2% GDP, and it's in the act that it will be supporting science and technology. Hence the creation of the National Research Fund. The National Research Fund just put out its first call for funding. It created a great deal of excitement in the academic and research sectors, because this was the first time that the government of Kenya was actually putting out calls in substantial amounts for people to compete with, Kenyan institutions to compete with. The calls were put out in several areas. One key area for which the calls were put out was infrastructure capacity building. And the government committed projects that were $1 million and beyond per project. So that's actually, I think, for us, it's and as a scientist myself, having been in the field for many years, I felt that that was a really big leap. But there were also other calls in the area of training postdoctoral fellows, training master students, and also supporting multidisciplinary research. So I want to say that I think we are moving in the right direction. Perhaps the government might not be able to commit all 2% at once, but it is committed to moving in a phased manner to achieve that target. Now, let me move back to some of the issues that were raised here. Regarding cancer, I'm glad to know that Merck is involved in this field and involved with our oncologists from Kenya, because it is a disease that has been of great concern, public health concern in Kenya. I can see that you have sought to have collaborations with India and transfer some of this knowledge back to University of Nairobi. India continues to be a partner in this field, because if you look at cancer, not only in Kenya, but in most African countries, India is the venue that patients go to for treatment. That is those who can afford treatment in cancer. Those who can't are left to the national services, which are overstretched. I know that in Kenya for many years we had one maybe on and off functional radiotherapy machine, and it was a serious problem. But in the last administration, government administration, we had two ministries of health. We had a ministry of public health and sanitation, and we had a ministry of medical services. Those of you who are familiar with the politics of Kenya may understand why those two ministries were created, but it was a power-sharing arrangement. And both the ministers who were in charge of those ministries actually became cancer victims. And they sought treatment outside. Thank God they are well and fine now, but that made a change in government commitment towards tackling cancer. And since then, I think there have been a lot of progress in that area. Very recently, the Prime Minister of India made a state visit to Kenya, and there were some arrangements that were made, and the country is preparing to build a facility that is dedicated to cancer and promote cancer treatment and prevention.
You know, the main objective of this UNESCO Merck Africa Research Summit is to bring researchers together. And many of you here, I heard today, talked about the importance of basically working together in Africa. Of course, it's important to do collaboration outside with the outside world. The North-South collaborations are important, but South-South collaboration are still weak. And within the region, within the continent itself, we find that researchers do not actually know what the others are doing in the same country, let alone in the same region. So this is really why we are here, you know. A lot of the researchers are here who have not met each other. They live in the same country, but they don't know what each other are doing. So I really wanted to say this and to invite your support, really, because we need the support of governments to bring these people together. I mean, it's not an easy task. It's not a cheap task. So I think, in order to promote this and to strengthen this more, we need the sort of the commitment and the support of your governments so we can move and we continue to do this. Because most of the time, publications, when you look at scientific publications, they're not between African universities. They're usually an African university with a university in the US and Europe. And we want to encourage more of these type of scientific publication, because this is the way I think the continent will move.
The first one by professor from Nigeria, I totally agree with the way you analyzed our situation, dividing those of us who were trained out and the way you put them. One part not coming, the other coming, but getting lost. Others staying in the system as you are. Yeah, all of them are important for Africa. Those who stay abroad, if they get connected to their system virtually, helping their institutions, their country, that's what people nowadays call brain gain. We can benefit from that and establish our system. Those who have come to their country and working for government, as I am, can also contribute a lot by bridging the probably not very strong bond between government and academia, government and the research sector. And the third category, like you are doing a great job, continue doing that. One point I picked from you is the importance of inter-Africa collaboration. I'd like to mention one very good example. An example from the World Bank Group. World Bank Group came up with an initiative in 2013 to have African centers of excellence. Excellence centers in different disciplines to be established in one of African countries, but to be utilized by many other African countries. We have many in West and Central African countries a couple of years back, and about last year, I guess, we have about 10 Eastern Southern African countries which have established a good number of centers of excellence. Those centers of excellence and their likes, which will be established in the future. A very good example is the Merck Center in Nairobi, can help us for connection. Through that kind of inter-Africa collaboration connection, we can build what we have and contribute what we get from that connection for our national and regional development endeavors. Second important point is on communication. We are not very good in communicating what we generate in our laboratories, what we see in our field surveys to the wider public. We need to strengthen that. A very good example we have in my country is we have started to link our academic institutions to communicate the research findings to the public via their local radio stations, via once per week or once per month TV programs, and through policy briefs which they publish in local language, which would be used by local community, etc., etc. So I totally agree with what our sister from Sudan also said. Communication of what we find in our research is very important to be transmitted to the community. Last point by Dr. Hamdi, you hit a very nice point. Yes, we need to bring our ministers of finance to our system. In our organizational structure, for example, in Ethiopian Science, Technology, Innovation Council, the minister of Ministry of Finance and Economic Cooperation is a member of that council. At the second level, in our National Research Council, the state minister of Ministry of Finance is also a member of the National Research Council. So by so doing, we get our top level decision makers in line with funding to our national mechanism. If we do the same, the agenda won't be new, and they would also take into their sectoral agendas and help the other system to function. So thank you very much.
I would like to address this topic with Mrs. Cooper, because there is a Sierra Leone Ethics and Scientific Review Committee. It's going to be established or has been established in Sierra Leone. So I would like to know, for you to tell us about it and how this came up to the horizon, and what is the motives of conducting it now and not before. I mean, just some feedback or overview about this ethics.
Ethics committee was already in existence, but what came out loud and clear was the inconsistency of different people doing different stuff. Nobody knew. I think somebody mentioned that. Nobody knew what the other person was doing. So during the EVD crisis, we decided to revisit this policy. Changes were made, and it's directly now under the Ministry of Health and Sanitation. What it does is keep the ministry in the loop of what's going on. A typical example is recently we had a little community where the goats were dying and nobody knew what happened. So we had some researchers go there and they found out there were worms. So the goats were dewormed, and that gave us an opportunity to spread around the surrounding communities, and the deworming went on and the goats stopped dying. But what this committee actually does is control the way the research is done. It's control it. WHO knows what CDC is doing. CDC knows what UNICEF is doing. And we know when samples are being taken out of the country, which was not happening before this committee was revisited. I mean, we had our specimens leaving the country, blood specimens, different kind of specimens, people coming, doing research without the Ministry of Health knowing what they were doing. And we get to find out again, communication. We, Sierra Leoneans, did not even know what some of the researches were about. We had no idea. But with this ethics committee now, we're able to manage the information, we're able to manage the data, and we're able to control what happens in our country.
Angolan government invested about 200 million dollars for infrastructure of research in agriculture, in health, and fishery. But what happened? What happened? No. The problem is that when we bought all this equipment, we realized that we don't have the human resources. We have to start with the human resources, not the money, but the human resources. Thank you.
I totally believe in this concept. And that's what I said about the cancer care and other challenges we have in health or research. So there is another comment from...
I'm reminded about a question that the Minister for Science and Technology, Ethiopia, asked Dr. Frank when he was sitting up here in the earlier panel, and that was about the experience in Ethiopia in terms of industry taking up R&D. And of course, I started thinking about that. But there is one thing, a challenge that I want to throw to all the scientists here. We are talking about empowering Africa in research, but I think we need to look deeply at what we mean by research, because research is a continuum. It's a spectrum. It starts at one end, it goes to another end, and it depends on what you're talking about. If you talk about industry and why they don't want to take R&D on, is because if you look, you will see most of our industries are not based on an R&D foundation. They are more of packaging and processing industries where R&D may not appeal to them. I'm sure Merck will agree with me that R&D is very important, starting all the way from basic research all the way into translating that research, going to clinical trials, going through those clinical trials, and all that spectrum that we know. So I think it's important for us as we talk about these things to understand what is it we want to strengthen. And in my own experience, I have been a basic researcher, I have moved on to other areas of clinical research and so on. But I know that basic research is an area that is critically lacking in African countries. In other words, if we don't own the research questions and say we want to find out something, we will not be able to deliver it at the end. So there are always arguments about basic research, saying that this is being done in the developed world. We don't want to put resources into it because it is being done. But it must be done by us, and we must do it. We must find out what type of molecules we want to develop, what kind of products you want to develop. So I think that is something that we need to seriously think on. And as we build this capacity, we must build it at every level. If you look at what's going on in Africa today, the lack of publications and all of that, we are more at the far end where we are doing more clinical trials with partners from outside. And yes, it develops us, but I do not think we gain the full benefits of being involved in research. Thank you.